Tonight is the first night for many of you in having a high school student. We'll talk about that because it really is the beginning. Now, how many of you are first-time high school parents? Raise my hand. Okay. First-time students, first ever in the family coming to the high school? Wow. Incredible. Okay, so all year long, I'll share your pain. My son will be a ninth grader at a different high school, but we're going through the same process right now as a family, as you are. So tonight, you get to be introduced to some important staff members, obviously our administrative team. You're going to meet some guidance counselors, learn who some of the department heads or the different subject disciplines they are. But really, what is the process for registration? And what can you do as a parent to help this transition at this point be as successful as possible? So there's going to be a lot of information. We had the ninth graders, or soon-to-be ninth graders, excuse me. We had them up here on Tuesday. We had a presentation for them. And then we had guidance counselors that went to the middle school on Wednesday. So tonight we're here with you, and we're going to give you as much information as possible. What we really want to do is help you make an informed decision so that when you're sitting down reviewing the program of studies and course selection guide, you understand what the different courses are, what the prerequisites are, and what the levels are. Try to make the best decisions moving forward so that we can have a solid transition to the high school for your son or daughter next year. There's also aspects to tonight besides the core subjects, if you will. We have a tremendous elective program. And that was something that I was even talking about with my wife, looking at the elective program at our high school versus this high school, and then looking at all the opportunities. That is something that's gonna be really important. Take a lot of time to look at that. The elective courses offer a unique time during the day for students to have a different setting, a different type of learning taking place typically. And it really is a tremendous program here at the high school. So I would spend as much time on that in your spare time with your children as possible so you can get an idea of what are the best electives that suit your son or daughter's interests, especially moving forward. Now, before I turn this over to Mrs. Hilger, our department head for guidance, I do want to mention that as much as you can, and take some time, look at where your child, if he or she knows where they want to be in 4 years. If they know where they want to be, what areas possibly of study, look at what those courses look like at the end. So try to begin with, when they leave Parkland High School, I want to be able to accomplish X, Y, and Z. And by the time they're a senior, this is where they want to be. And try to work backwards a little bit as much as you can. It'll help you, it'll help them. But as much as we can, we're trying to set up some pathways for students so that they can maximize the program that we have with their passions and their interests and their ability levels so that they, when they leave the high school, they are fully set and very well prepared. We've done an excellent job with that. Our track record speaks to that. We have students come back to us and tell us how well prepared they are for freshman year of college, sophomore year of college. Now I know your children are gonna work very, very hard. And we're gonna talk about that again when we meet in August for that orientation meeting we have the parents in, or it's the beginning of September. But we'll talk about that again. It's gonna be a transition. We'll want to stay positive, keep plugging away, put the nose to the grindstone, and they're going to work extremely hard. They're going to leave here with incredible education. And they're going to write letters to their teachers like I've received every single day for the past 2 weeks. I've had a teacher stop me and tell me how they received a letter from a former student over break. It is unbelievable. But that's the quality of the education that the students are receiving. It's going to be a lot of work, though. So as we go through this transition, I'm going to bring up Mrs. Hilger. She's going to talk to you about the rest of the registration process. And we'll be available for the rest of the evening, and I'll close after our department heads are done. But thank you for coming out.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. for me. So I just want to welcome the parents of the class of 2020 to Parkland High School for the first time here. As Mr. Manish shared, we met with the students on Tuesday morning. I think they were a bit overwhelmed. There's a bit of a glazed look in their eyes as they sat through a presentation that was, oh gosh, maybe almost an hour and a half long. We sent Mr. Hughes to Springhouse and Mrs. McGar, two of our counselors. She went over to OMS to answer questions the next day. We thought we'd give them a little bit of time at night to process all that information and to ask any questions that they may have. I was told they were pretty quiet, actually. So I'm not sure, maybe they're talking to you at home. Hopefully they are. Hopefully, yesterday, you have seen this maybe come out of the backpack, but this is the Parkland High School 2016-17 course study guidebook. This has everything in it that you need. Please take a close look at this. You should see, I don't think you've seen this one yet, but I think in the next week and a half, the middle schools will also be handing out the green freshman registration form. So you will be seeing that. I believe that will have audit recommendations that the middle school teachers will be making, and you'll be able to take a look at that and complete that with your child so that we can hopefully schedule them over the summer. There's just an enormous amount of information, and I thought what I could do for you is maybe just break some of this down a little bit for you, give you some of the basics tonight before you hear from each of the different department chairs. So to begin with, to graduate, as Mr. Manish said, we kind of need to look at the end, and we need to make sure 24.25 credits are required to graduate. If you see in this course study guidebook, page 9 is very, very important. It has all the requirements that for graduation for your child. We're talking, we need 4 credits of English, we need 4 credits of social studies, 3 credits of math, 3 credits of science. We're looking at 1.25 health and physical education credits. Within the electives, we're looking for 1 credit of technology, 3 credits of arts and humanities, and the remaining elective credits can be open electives. Their choice, things they're interested in, things that they think they might like to explore a little bit more. We will guide them as they go through this process and make sure that they are meeting the requirements and communicate with you and stay in touch with you if we are concerned about any graduation requirements as they move through the system and move through the grade levels. But again, that page 9 is pretty important in the Program of Studies booklet. In terms of how the schedule works at the high school, I think it's a little bit different from what I understand that it is at the middle school. We have 9 periods up here at the high school, and we have 6 cycle days, so that gives us 54 available periods that we can actually schedule a student. In there, they need to eat, so they need to have lunch. It's usually one of the favorite things for them to do. And we need to schedule a minimum of 6.25 credits in 9th grade. That is considered full-time students, and as per Parkland School Board, all students need to have a minimum of 6.25. We do try to schedule for the freshmen if we possibly can and give them a little bit of a cushion and a head start. Perhaps if we can give them an extra elective. I'll talk about the electives just in a little bit. Just to begin with, the core subject areas. Every 9th grader needs to schedule a level of English, a level of social studies, a level of math, and a level of science. And when I talk about levels, there are many different levels actually the students can choose from. And that's why it's so important that I know the middle school teachers who really do know their child best will be making that recommendation to you for 9th grade. But it definitely is a team effort, and it's a discussion that you can have with the teacher, with the child, with the counselor, and they hopefully make that best selection. When I talk about levels, there are levels that include the career readiness, career education and work readiness level. We also have a seminar level. These are levels that will have additional supports built within them. The career education and work readiness level is a level that we would be actually partnering and having the students attend LCTI, our technical school. We then move on to, as I said, seminar. There's academic college preparatory levels, gifted high potential. We have honors levels, and I know Mr. Schwartz is going to do an excellent job of explaining all of those levels to you as we go through the presentation this evening. You'll also be hearing about the course requirements. They'll be talking about summer assignments for the honors level courses so that you have a better understanding of what the expectations are in each of the areas. In English, in history, and mathematics, these are scheduled in a single period format, meaning that there's 44-minute class periods that the students will be attending each day in those areas. In science, we typically, for most of them, science classes, not all, but most, we have that in a double period format, in an 88-minute period format. There's a fifth core subject area that we do encourage the students, if at all possible, and that's the world language area. Many of the students have begun the world languages. They're at level one of the world language, and we would encourage them to continue on into level two. If your student is struggling in a world language or in the area of mathematics, we would encourage perhaps they may want to repeat a level to just get that solid foundation before they move forward, or maybe move into a different level, for example, of a world language, and begin again with level one. So again, that's a discussion that you would have at home and with the teachers. As far as electives, we're asking for 1.5 credits of electives to be scheduled. We are asking for the students to hopefully select electives that they have an interest in. I was telling them that actually when we do schedule electives, we're also asking for alternate electives. The reason is there are 3,200 plus students in this building, and so that's a lot of students to schedule, so there's not a guarantee that they'll get that first or second choice. So I want to make sure that they really do select the electives, and even if it's their third or fourth choice, that they'd be happy with that, and they'd like to really, you know, explore that. We have so many electives, over 100, I believe. The program is very extensive, and I know they can find something that I think they would enjoy. I also like to, just talking about those electives, make sure too that you take a close look at the prerequisites. So when you go through the course study guidebook, you'll want to read the description of the elective and basically take a look and make sure if there's a prerequisite that's included there. So for example, if a student is interested in a residential architecture class, we need to make sure they've got the intro to drafting class as a prereq. Or if they're looking to take American foods, they need basic foods first. So there are some prerequisites that are in place that we want to check out. There's also another area that is required for graduation, that's health and physical education. So each and every year, we do require that particular course. It's typically also taught in that double period format for 88 minutes. I know Mrs. Haynes will be here this evening and share a little bit more about health and PE if you would have any questions about that. When I'm talking about graduation requirements, I started with the 24.25 credits. We're also looking at an online career exploration course that is a requirement that we move the students through in 9th and 10th grade. This gives the students another opportunity to continue with those modules. They begun with the career cruising. I believe they started that with InfoTech and then 7th grade guidance classes, and we'll be continuing that to help them hopefully define what that post-secondary plan might be when they leave Parkland High School. So that's definitely something that will happen for the class of 2020. There's a third piece to the graduation requirements. I'm hesitating a little bit because as the Department of Education seems to change, and I'm gonna look at Mr. Moniz, I'm not even sure if a vote was taken, but as of right now, I believe keystones are still on the table for the students in the class of 2020, and that's in Algebra 1, and that's in Literature and Biology. But please stay posted for that, and we'll continue to keep you updated with that. We have another option for our students, and that's the Lehigh Career and Technical School. We're very lucky, 5 minutes up the road here on 309, to have one of the premier technical schools in the state, if not even in the nation. 30 different technical labs. Our students have a half-day program option in 9th grade available to them. Our students, when they go up there for half-day in the morning, come back to us, and we'll schedule them for an English, social studies, math, and a science course then back here at Parkland High School. Please understand that students going to LCTI may take, some of them are in a career education work readiness levels, but I have students who are in college prep and gifted levels going up to LCTI. So please know one of the benefits of this large high school is that we can blend these academic programs for our students and give them every best opportunity possible. In addition to these courses I've explained, we do have some summer enrichment opportunities. So I'm going to give Mrs. Bennett a plug right now. And on your schedule in the breakout sessions, you will see that she is, I'm not sure what room, but she'll hopefully, you can find her on the schedule here. But we do have some summer enrichment opportunities, whether we're talking about 2 or 4 year accredited college courses, accredited online programs, or through live enrichment opportunities here at Parkland High School. There is a summer enrichment packet that would be due back to Mrs. Bennett for approval by April 22nd. So that's a breakout, and if you're interested in that, you may want to pursue that and take a look at that a little bit. I will be up in B131 talking a little bit about dual enrollment with parents after in the breakout sessions. I think I just saw Mrs. McGar. I know Mr. Gordon and Mr. Humes are here with me this evening so that we can answer any questions that you may have. Again, welcome to the class of 2020 and to the parents here of 2020. I'm going to turn it over now to Mr. Tim Schwartz, who is the chairperson for the English department.
Since I'm annually chosen to be the first chairperson of each department to speak tonight, I always like to start off with a quote. Thomas Edison once said that vision without execution is hallucination. And right now, your sons and daughters and you are in the vision stage. And on behalf of the English department and the staff here at Parkland High School, I'm happy to lead, teach, and guide your students and you through the process of them executing your vision that you have shown up here tonight. So thank you very much. In terms of the English department, I wanted to first go through the content, the content level at each grade. And for the ninth grade, the content level is American literature from its beginnings to 1900, with also Native American literature and colonial literature, as well as supplementary readings that go back and forth between time periods. And then when your sons or daughters go through 10th grade, that's a continuation of the American literature period from 1900 to the present, and again, it has supplementary readings. In 11th grade, it switches from American literature to English literature, English and British literature. And it goes from the beginnings of the English language to the Romantic period of 1798. And again, it also has supplementary readings that are English and world literature from different time periods mixed in. And then in 12th grade, it's a mix of British and world literature from 19th century England to the present day, and also including supplementary readings. Also, each level includes intensive grammar, specifically with 9th and 10th grade. The grammar, in terms of its content and requirements for grade levels, eases up in 11th and 12th grade, and it's a main focus in 9th grade for next year. There's also writing, exclusively writing themes, essays, paragraphs. It's a subject of English, so we're going to be communicating a lot through writing. And vocabulary varies from different level to level in academic levels, but it's required in the English department as part of our curriculum. And also Keystone preparation. The 10th grade class just took their Keystone literature test in December, and then any student that has not passed that yet in 11th grade and 10th grade will retake that again in May, so we prepare them as well for that in the English class. And then there's also college and career preparation, and this is a big change in the English department this year in the sense that we're doing away with the applied level, of that academic level of applied, and we're switching to a career and education and work program that's going to focus on the ideas of career exploration, with the idea and the goal that by the time your sons or daughters are in 11th grade, they're either going to make a choice of they're going to continue with a current level that they may be in, if it's a career level or a college preparatory level or above, that in 11th grade they will decide whether they're going to be thinking about going to college or thinking about going to work after high school graduation. And we want to have the English classes available to them that will help them in that process and prepare them for whichever choice they choose to do. I invite you to check out the Parkland High School website. We have 25 and a half English teachers at the current time. Half, meaning there's one teacher who teaches two classes here at the high school and three classes at the middle schools. And you can always go on the website and look up the English staff to look at and explore the websites that the English teachers may have and see the kinds of things that are available at each level. All the syllabi and all the materials that each teacher will do are on their websites. Okay, now I'm going to get into the different academic levels in descending order in terms of their rigor. And a lot of these levels correspond to the other departments and other disciplines as well, so you'll be hearing about these a lot. This is basically the track that your sons or daughters and you are choosing for them. The honors and AP level, in the English department, we offer honors at 9th and 10th grade, and then the same track is the AP classes in 11th and 12th grade, AP Language and Communication in 11th grade, and AP Literature and Communication in 12th grade. This is a more scholarly and accelerated level, and it prepares students for future honors and AP courses with the eventual goal of them performing well on the 11th grade AP Language and Communication Composition exam, and then in 12th grade the AP Literature and Composition exam to earn college credit for a particular score that they may have. The vocab book at the honors and AP level is one level above all the other academic levels, and to continue on in that track, a final grade of B assures a placement in the next year's pathway course. There's also a summer assignment for the honors and AP level for each of the grade levels, a different book, and maybe like an 8-hour assignment that is a required summer piece for those particular classes. One level below the AP and honors is Gifted High Potential, or GHP. This uses college preparatory as a basis, but it's more advanced, so I'll call it, it's not necessarily the academic and fast-paced level that AP and honors is, but it's an advanced content level. And the resources, processes, pace, breadth of material, and research is more a faster pace for the students. So that basically in GHP, compared to college prep, they're doing more in less time, and more is expected of them at this level. And the content is differentiated, and there's an on-level vocab book for those classes. Then there's college preparatory. This is the main course that students would take to prepare for life beyond Parkland High School at a higher institution of learning. It's an academic level. It has a slower pace and less content and intensity of work than the GHP, but it's still crisply paced for college level readiness, and it has an online vocabulary book. And then below the college preparatory level is the seminar level. And this includes a more of a team approach to learning, offering a wide range of studies, and the standards are in place to improve deficient English skills in all areas in these classes. The idea of a seminar in 9th and 10th grade is to hopefully prepare that student so that by the time they get to 11th grade, they may be able to jump back up to a college preparatory level, or if not, then decide to go into that career in education and work pathway. In both the 9th and 10th grade classes in seminar, it is a single period class, single period for English, but it also has to be paired with the seminar class for history. So it's going to be integrated with the history and co-taught with a history teacher as well. And now the next slide, I did include the applied level up there, but this is, like I said, for the eighth graders coming to ninth grade, there is not going to be applied level offered. It's the college and education and work level, which is more of a traditional academic education with a concentration in career preparation. And students who select this class must also be enrolled at the same time at LCTI, because this is the idea that they're going to be going into the work world following high school. And it focuses on effective communication. And again, you could take the College of Education and Work class while enrolled at LCTI, and if that's not a challenge, or if a student decides maybe by the time in 11th grade that he or she may think about going to college, we're going to encourage that student to then jump up to the college preparatory level to prepare them for the rigor that they would see in college. So those are the different levels that you'll be hearing all night from the different department chairs and the different disciplines. And now here's my commercial for the English department. Our electives are very wide ranging. We have electives in publishing with the yearbook in our school newspaper. We have Creative Writing 1, Creative Writing 2, and Journalism with Writing. We have many different and award-winning stage programs with theater arts, acting, technical theater, lighting, stage, and sound design. But we also have electives in communication with our top-rated school media center for Intro to Mass Communication, Video and Film Production, our Television News Studio, or PMN, and we also offer an elective in public speaking, which I'm currently teaching right now. And then our literature and general electives are Greek and Roman mythology, sports and literature, women writers, and learning strategies. And several of these courses haven't been offered in recent years because there haven't been enough students who register for them. There's a minimum number of students that need to register for these classes to run. So I mean, if your student is interested in any of these literature general electives or even the communications electives, encourage them to do so and spark that interest so that we will run the class and maybe it's something that they would find, that they might want to find a career in and use those electives for. And then the last thing I'll say tonight on behalf of the English department is that the clubs that we offer. We offer a National English Honor Society that students are eligible for in 11th grade for English. We do have a literature magazine, so any student who is creative in terms of writing or artistic endeavors might want to get involved with the Lit Mag. And we also have a cultural awareness club, our CARE club, which is Cultures Achieve Respect Everywhere. If you have more questions for me personally, I will be in A125 for the three breakout sessions following this meeting. So I encourage you to come and I'll answer any questions that I can and get into specifics with the different academic levels that we offer in the English department. So thank you very much for your attention tonight. I will now turn the program over to Mrs. Mel Stinner from the Math Department. She's the chair of the Math Department. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Schwartz. Good evening and welcome to Parkland High School. I can think about a decade ago, I was sitting here for the first time, just like you, as both my children have gone through this process and are now college graduates, so you're in a good spot. You're going to get a lot of good information this evening, and please don't be afraid to ask questions. In the Program of Studies book, I'm going to try to keep the math choice relatively simple. We always have a few quirks you have to work out, but in this coursebook, and in the packet, I believe, that you picked up tonight, there is a grid that goes with the math choices. And essentially, the idea is you're going to find the course that your son or daughter is currently taking in eighth grade, and then move to the right into the ninth grade column. Everything is sequential in mathematics. And Parkland's sequence of events, probably starting back in earlier middle school, is you move from pre-algebra to algebra 1, to algebra 2, to geometry, to college algebra. If you notice now, it moves now to pre-calculus. If you have older sons or daughters in the district, that course up until this year was called trigonometry, analytic geometry. It is changing for next year. It's now pre-calculus. It's the same course, we're just changing the curriculum a little bit. And then you can move to the calculus sequence. All right, so find the course you're in now, move on to the right. The choices that need to be made are not in the path. The choices are in the level. And just like Mr. Schwartz just explained all the levels, in mathematics we have our honors and AP level, which is our very highly theoretical, abstract, fast-paced, right, group of track that you're going through. We have gifted high potential, right, which is your CP base, but more content, faster pace, etc. And then you have your CP, your standard college preparatory curriculum. So if you're moving from that eighth grade column to the ninth grade column and you're moving from one block and it splits into two, then you have a choice to make in terms of level. In that choice, please consider your sons or daughters' interests, their motivation levels, their abilities. Please, if you need a recommendation, ask their current teacher. You want to challenge your son or daughter, but you don't want to frustrate them either. So you have to put some thought to it and have some discussions. Ask as many questions as you would like. As Mrs. Pilgert said, each course has a description. So in the course booklet, the next couple pages, 36 through 40, you'll see a course description for every course. So once you see what the course is, go look up the description, because some of them do have prerequisites. And if you don't meet the prerequisite, you can't go into that course. So you want to pay attention to that. All AP and honors courses do have a summer assignment, which will be posted on the school website, I think sometime in late May or June, that will be posted. We do have an array of electives in the math department, but as a ninth grader, until you build that background, it's sort of limited right away here in ninth grade. Pretty much a math elective in ninth grade might be a computer programming one and a computer programming two. The other electives, as they move through the school and they get to be juniors, seniors, etc., that list opens up, and then we move into some statistics-based and some other electives that will open up. But for right now, in the ninth grade, it would be computer programming one and two, and you have to take one before you take two. In terms of activities within our department, we have a very competitive Parkland Math League. Our students are very successful in statewide and national competitions. Your sons and daughters, if they're interested in that, can sign up for that in the fall when they get here. We have a computer club. We have technology interns. We have a math honor society, which I believe is your junior year until you're eligible for that. There's certain requirements for that. As Mrs. Pilgrim said, as of right now, and it might change tomorrow, but right now, the class of 2020, we are still bound by the Keystone exams. We are testing next week in Algebra 1. Kids who maybe didn't pass last year when they took it in May or over the summer, we are doing retests. And then students who are currently in Algebra 1, if you're currently in Algebra 1, you'll be doing your Keystone test in May of this year, right? So if you're in the course now, you'll be taking it in May. The ones who are testing next week are the ones who already took it and need to retest. Many of your students, many of them, will complete this requirement in middle school. Many of them are taking Algebra 1 in 7th and 8th grade and will pass and be fine, not have to worry about it when they get here. If that goal has not been met, then no matter what math class you end up next year, will probably be Algebra 2. If you haven't passed it, we provide remediation somehow in the student's schedule, whether it be in class with the Algebra 2 teacher, or sometimes we will pull out from study halls, etc. So your son or daughter might see on their schedule something called Math Lab. It's because we're taking them out of a study hall to work on the Keystone exam so that when they retest, all right, they're fresh with the material. Summer enrichment, I'm going to deflect all those questions on summer enrichment to Mrs. Bennick. She will be in room B125 tonight, but we do have summer enrichment offerings in the math department, Algebra 2, Geometry, College Algebra, etc. They're offered in different formats. Some of them are face-to-face, some of them are online, but she'll be going through all of those requirements and the process, etc. She'll be in B125 when we break out in a little bit. Please don't be afraid to ask questions. I will be in C200 tonight. My email is on the school website. Please don't be afraid to send a question. I try to respond as quickly as possible to have the answer for you. Or your guidance counselor or your son or daughter's current math teacher. Please ask anyone to make the best choice possible. Thank you. I'm going to turn the program over to Mr. Fuso, who is in charge of the science department.
Sean Fuso, I'm the chairperson of the science department. I'm representing the 24 highly dedicated and professional science teachers that we have here at Parkland High School. I teach physics here at the high school. A couple things I want to really emphasize tonight, that there are four disciplines in the science department, if you look through the course catalog, and those would be earth science, biology, chemistry, and physics. If you also notice on our graduation requirements, we do only require 3 years of science in order to graduate. We do highly, highly recommend, though that you take all 4 years of science if possible. To speak personally, I really wasn't sure what I was going to go into. I went to Parkland when I was a senior. I was maybe going to go the business route until I took physics my senior year. And I just fell in love with the subject. So I always say students don't really know what they want to do or go into until they've at least taken a course in it. The choices for incoming freshmen are actually pretty simple. So even though we offer a wide variety of science electives and various levels and different types of courses, going into ninth grade here, the traditional pathway, if you can see, would be to take earth science in ninth grade, biology in 10th grade, chemistry in 11th, and then physics as a senior. I should mention, though, in order to take some of the AP courses that we offer, sometimes students have to either double up their freshman year or they go right to honors biology. So that would be one choice that you'll have to explore with your child and your guidance counselor. I really encourage you to have a good discussion of that. I really don't want to encourage skipping earth science. Unfortunately, we have so many different offerings that sometimes the only way in order to get to AP courses is to bypass one of those different disciplines that we have in science. The four levels that we have in earth science are very similar to what Mr. Schwartz was talking about here. So these would be more of your choices going into ninth grade. We have the honors level, the gifted high potential level, the college prep level, and we also still offer the applied level for our science courses. We meet a little differently. Mrs. Pilgrim alluded to this, that we meet in science generally every other day for an hour and a half. So it is a bit of an adjustment for ninth graders coming in. We have a different set of responsibilities. Sometimes, if you're absent, say on a Thursday, students sometimes don't have class from Tuesday until the following Monday. So that is a bit of an adjustment in there. I also want to mention that students shouldn't feel like they're trapped in a certain level. So if your son or daughter would pick college prep level as a freshman and they really enjoy science and they feel they have a higher ability to challenge themselves a little bit more, they can always advance a level. Likewise, if they struggle in a particular level, they can also transfer to an easier level. So if we look at what we're generally asking for honors earth science for next year, we're asking for a current teacher recommendation. There is a summer assignment involved. It generally takes about 8 to 10 hours. That's over the course of the whole summer. That they have advanced reading and math skills, a strong work ethic, that they're an independent learner, and they also have a strong interest in science. For the GHP, gifted high potential level, a current teacher recommendation, strong reading and math skills. They're capable of independent work. They're also interested in science, a reliable and responsible student as well. College prep and GHP are very, very similar in our science curriculum. They use the same textbooks. They go at relatively the same pace. One of the main differences is in the GHP level, they go into a little bit more depth. Their problem solving is a little bit more advanced, and they also have a number of enrichment activities. So again, college prep and GHP are very close, very, very close to the same thing. Current teacher recommendation for college prep, average reading and math skills, and also responsible student. Onto our applied level earth science. These are more hands-on courses. They are designed that if students need a little more learning support, we often have learning support teachers' aides in the classroom. And again, they're designed to be hands-on. If students are in child's reading and math skills, they need a little bit of improvement. Or if your child might be going into LCTI, a lot of those students end up in applied earth science. These classes, because of the support and the needs, end up meeting every day on a single period. And some students have a better adjustment with that. But once again, should you choose one of those levels for your son or daughter, please don't feel like you're trapped in that level throughout their whole high school career. And again, one of the other choices would be to take honors biology as an incoming freshman. And this is something, again, to please discuss with your child's guidance counselor, or also their current teachers. Some students already know they want to go the engineering route and are going to need to take or want to take AP physics classes or possibly our AP chemistry or environmental science or AP biology. To have that time and schedule to take those AP courses, you'll need to take the prerequisite course for that level as a junior. So in order to fulfill those needs, sometimes students end up having to skip earth science or double up their freshman year. So the other choice would be to take honors biology concurrently or in place of earth science. So the requirements for that are a teacher recommendation, strong aptitude and future in science, advanced math and reading skills. There is a summer assignment involved with that as well. There is long-range research projects in the class. And again, we would like the child to be a mature, responsible, independent, and motivated student. I should mention that, as Mrs. Snyder talked about in biology as well, we're also bound by the Keystone exams for right now. I hope that people don't have much anxiety over these. Every year, Parkland has been getting better and better at this. We have lots of measures in place, so if a student doesn't pass the first time around, this would be taken after their biology course. So if they're coming in as a freshman taking earth science, they wouldn't take the Keystone exam until they're done with biology their 10th grade year. But at the completion of biology, they do have, as mandated by the state, they have to take that Keystone exam. Should they not pass the first time, we have lots of systems in place. We have after-school biology boot camp that's been highly successful, where we can actually get a prescription for each individual student. We work with them on a one-to-one basis. We also pull them out of study halls, and we can remediate them during the school day. And our retesters are doing better and better at passing that exam. So again, it's something that we have a lot of systems in place to sort of reduce the anxiety of. I should also mention there are other options and pathways available. If your child is very, very advanced, we do have a number of special case students that are coming into the high school already having passed a lot of the math courses that we offer at the high school level. So in some cases, we actually have a few 9th graders and 10th graders that are already taking AP Physics 1. I don't need to get into all of that in front of everybody here, but if you do have some individual questions about that, child is one of those cases where they're already advanced and you're looking at that as a possible option, you can see me about that. I'll be in C210 after this session. We also have after school activities, so the Science Fair Club and the Science Olympiad Club are both highly competitive and usually do very, very well. I know there's a cohort of students coming up from the middle schools in Science Olympiad, and they've been highly, highly successful for the last few years. So again, if you have any other questions, I'll be in C210 after this session. And we appreciate everyone coming out tonight. As teachers, I can definitely say we appreciate the great parental support that we get here at Parkland High School. So that's an essential part of what we do here over the years, that you as parents keep encouraging your students to push themselves to their best abilities. At the same rate, we still want them to have a great experience here at the high school. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Mrs. Steinball. She's going to tell you about our social studies program.
Good evening, and welcome on behalf of the Social Studies Department. I am so excited to see so many of you here. It bodes very well for your child's future that you're all here and that you care enough to spend this evening with us. So thank you. You can see from the visual up there that social studies is so much more than history, but don't worry, I know we have a lot of choices and it seems overwhelming right now. The path through social studies at Parkland is actually very simple. It starts out in 9th grade and 10th grade with U.S. history, progresses in 11th grade to world studies, in 12th grade with economics and government, and as you climb that ladder of going from freshman to senior year, the opportunity for electives and for AP classes opens up as you go. Like other departments, of course, our course offerings come in a variety of course levels, which you've already heard a lot about. AP or honors levels, which would, in social studies as in other departments, involve a summer assignment. Gifted and high potential college prep, seminar courses in 9th and 10th grade, and then career education and work readiness classes. But with particular attention to the social studies department, honors and AP students in this department would be students who are excellent readers, excellent writers, and who are innately interested and curious about history and the social sciences. These are the kids who watch documentaries all on their own. And when they get to economics and psychology and sociology, these are also kids who have excellent math and quantitative thinking skills. And we're very excited about the new statistics courses for the humanities that will enhance these students' ability to thrive in those classes. When we're talking about the CEW courses, the Career Education and Work Readiness courses, the students in this class who choose this level must, as Mr. Swartz said, be enrolled in a technical or vocational course of study at LCTI. The content of these courses then will have a focus that is based on the needs of the students and their future employers in a 20th century workplace. So, for example, when they're studying history, when they're studying sociology, when they're studying psychology, economics, or government, they're going to learn to put in perspective the power of labor and the history of that power, the role of technological change, the role of history in globalization and where that might go in the future and how that would affect them in the workplace. The seminar classes are for students who are still on the fence as to whether, and I would say most students in 9th and 10th grade probably are, I'm still trying to figure out what I want to do when I grow up, but they're still on the fence or undecided about whether they are currently preparing for college immediately after high school or will be pursuing a career after graduation. So these classes are going to simultaneously prepare students for the rigor of college prep classes, if that is where they eventually decide to go, while also exploring their career options and getting them ready for that pathway as well. And any student who decides to sign up for a seminar class in 9th and or 10th grade will also sign up for a similar seminar class in the English department. Those two go hand in hand. In 9th grade then, as I said before, everyone will be taking American Studies 1 at some level, either honors, GHP, CP, seminar, or CEW level. LCTI students who are pursuing a technical course of study are not automatically channeled into those CEW or seminar courses. They can take CP, GHP, or even honors courses if they are so inclined. So don't feel that your child is stuck. If they're taking LCTI, if they have a proclivity for social studies and history, they can certainly take one of those higher level courses. In 9th grade, in social studies, you also have one of your first opportunities, if your child is so inclined, to try out an AP course. We are, for the first time next year, opening up our relatively new course, AP Human Geography, to 9th graders, for them to get a first exposure to an AP course. So that might be something that you're considering for your highly motivated student. In 10th grade, they are again taking American Studies, this time American Studies 2, from honors to the CEW level. Or they can take AP U.S. History. AP U.S. History then, instead of just doing half of American history, the second half, as 10th grade would, goes all the way back to the beginning, and then we'll finish at the end, so it actually moves twice as fast as the other U.S. history courses would. Covers everything all in 1 year. So it's a fast-moving course, a challenging course, but you get to take the AP, you get to take the AP test at the end. You also still have that human geography option out there as a different AP course, but you must take U.S. history at some level. In 11th grade, the must is world studies, so that has to be in there at some level, including AP. That's a possibility. But you'll notice that we open up the possibilities for more electives if they can fit those into their schedule as well. Everything from AP U.S. history and European history to psychology at either the AP or the general studies level, sociology, and again that human geography AP. In 12th grade, the required courses are twofold. You must take at least a semester of economics and at least one semester of government. One semester at least of each. If you take an AP level of either of those AP courses are year-long courses, so it's sometimes a struggle for students to fit those into their schedule. If they take a year-long AP U.S. government course or an AP comparative political systems course, they then also still have to take at least a semester of economics. And if they decide to take AP both economics and government courses, that's two whole scheduled periods now that are social studies. And while these students are often also the students who are trying to take every math and every science that we're offering here, that's sometimes difficult for them to fit in. Because of that, we do offer, and we're doing it this year for the first time, I have about 20 students who are in this class. We do offer the AP Economics course online, so when your students, I know that's a long way away from now to 12th grade, but they can look forward to perhaps being able to do that, and as we progress, perhaps have some other course offerings that are available online so they can do it on their own time. We also have our share of clubs and activities in the Social Studies department. We have a History Day club for your students who like to do History Day. We have a Political Science club, and I have to put in my own plug because I'm the advisor for it. The Scholastic Scrimmage club for the kids who just know everything about everything and like to prove it. And I've got a great strong bunch of 9th and 10th graders right now, so I'm looking forward to having your kids come up and help me out with that. I will be in C220 if you have any questions about social studies, or you can find my email in the staff listings at the high school. Please do feel free to contact me by email. It makes me feel important. So I'm now going to turn this over to our World Languages Chair, Senora O'Donnell. Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Steinball. Sometimes it's hard not to reflect on the evolution of Parkland. When I think about my grandmother, and she showed me a picture one time, and there she was standing in front of what was the Troxel building down the road. And she said, "Yes, I graduated from South Whitehall High School." I said, "Oh, Grandma, that was my junior high school." And then my daughter goes to OMS, and I say, "Oh, I graduated from that high school." She goes, "Well, it's middle school. We don't say junior high school anymore," and things like that. But anyway, that was my high school. And now my daughter is here in this brand new facility in 10th grade, and it's just amazing when you look at that course catalog, how Parkland has progressed and kept up with all these amazing offerings. And I'm so happy. She was so thrilled to go through the course catalog. She's excited. I'm excited for her. So it's just amazing the opportunities that are available at the fingertips of these students. Ahora, en español, buenas tardes a los padres de la clase de 2020. Welcome. Good afternoon to the parents of the students of the class of 2020. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of our offerings in the World Language Department. And we know no matter what career choice your son or daughter has, the benefits of language learning are endless. It could be anything from simple travel pleasure to job opportunities. A lot of teachers in my department always receive emails saying, "Well, because of my experience with German, I was able to go on this trip to do a service abroad, or I was able to have this internship because of what I did in your class," or many students end up switching their major in college, and they say, "Well, I'm glad I took that dual enrollment class or that AP course because now the credits count for my new major, which I didn't expect." So a lot of times, some of the benefits are unexpected, but there's tremendous benefits, especially in our global society today, to language learning. Parkland offers, what do colleges require, first of all? 2 years minimal of a language, and depending upon the major, some colleges require more. For example, if you're going into international business or international relations, they might require 4 to 5 years, but the minimal is 2 years, and it's recommended that you stay with the same language to increase your proficiency. You may also take more than one language. For example, you can take a Spanish 3, and then also take a Latin 1 or an American Sign Language 1, and the other language will count as an elective credit if that's one thing that your child is interested in. At the high school, we offer Spanish, French, German, American Sign Language, and Latin, and also through an extra fee, through LTRIC and through Penn State Lehigh Valley, we offer Arabic and Chinese, and that again is as long as we have the enrollment to run those courses. We offer levels 1 through 5 of French, German, and Spanish, And the honors level, we only have two tracks. We have the regular CP level, and we also have the honors level for levels 2 through 5. And later on, you can think about that dual enrollment. Dual enrollment in levels 4 and 5 is just by paying a tuition fee and receiving an A, B, or C. Your son or daughter can receive college credits, and that goes on a transcript for wherever they end up going to college. The big choice for an incoming ninth grader is to decide between a level 2 or 2 honors. And basically, the difference is this. The 2 honors courses will be conducted by the teacher exclusively in the target language. So the teacher will be using the language at all times. And it's something that takes adjusting to, but it's amazing. I know after a month, the students are used to it. If I say, pasan a la página 225, some kids might be like, what is that? But then they watch and somebody's like, somebody gets out a book and they're like, oh, we're supposed to get out a book, okay. So they just follow along. And the more they hear it, the more proficient they become. And in that track, by the end, they're able to take an AP course. In levels 4 and 5, they don't speak any English in those classes, and it's pretty amazing. They tell jokes in the language, they understand each other. So an honors student would be that student who is ready for an experience like that, who's self-motivated, who would take time to make vocabulary flashcards, who would study on their own and do a little independent learning. And the other classes also, you're going to learn a lot of culture, you're going to learn a lot of vocabulary, and those are our offerings here. Currently, there are no summer assignments for any honors language courses. If you can go back to that one, I think I forgot the film then. Oh, okay, I covered that, thank you. Additional benefits, every language has a club, and that's open 9th through 12th grade. And every language has a club. We have trips abroad, you just have to listen for the announcements. And available in grades 11 and 12, there's honor societies, and eventually college credit opportunities. And here are some pictures from the Church of Spain and our floats during homecoming. Muchas gracias. I'll be in room B103, and I'd like to turn it back to Mr. Moniz.
So just a couple of things that I would like to reiterate for everyone. I know at the middle school level, students are in teams. They're moving through. They're probably in the same level of course, all 4 subjects, maybe including the language. Please don't feel as if your son or daughter wants to be in honors, that they have to be completely an honor student, all subjects across the board. I know Mrs. Pilgrim's mentioned that, we probably all mentioned that, but I just want to say once again, the ninth grade transition is what it is. It's a transition, and a matter for the most confident of students, it can be a little nerve-wracking, but academically, we want them to be settled, we want them to be confident. So if you decide to choose, I would base it upon your son or daughter's interests, their skills, their passions. So if I can just say, when I come home and I look at my kitchen and I look above the sink and I say to my wife, what is that up on the ceiling there? Well, that's my 12-year-old science experiment that he decided to make that night in the kitchen. The 14-year-old wants nothing to do with it, but he's downstairs building something with Kinects. So, I have 3 boys, two of them especially, closest to, they're very different, and they have different passions. So think of that with your children. When they're coming to the high school, they don't have to be locked into an honors setting. The GHP class, the CP classes, find the one that's best for them. You want to have a smooth transition. You'll know in a four-year course, the first 12 days, they'll know if they're going to be challenged in that class or not. Because then there'll be time to move through the transition throughout the course of the year where they build confidence, they get their sea legs, they understand what they're doing, where they're going every day, and how they feel about planning their work and managing the workload that they're going to have. They can do that. And you'll know right away if they say, well, this is really easy, then you know. Maybe that's not the right setting for them at the time. We can make that adjustment early in the year. those first 12 days. Vice versa, if it is too rigorous of a setting and there's major overload going on, then you need to look at that because we want to have a good transition. And no one graduated from high school after the ninth grade year. No one was accepted to college after the ninth grade year. So vice versa, you don't want them to be over striving to do everything all at once because there's still 3 more years of school. And you don't want to underwhelm them to the point where they're not being pushed enough. And I think you'll be able to manage that as parents, but trying to keep that in mind to balance it out based on their needs. So again, I think Mr. Skinner said it best, challenge, but do not frustrate. That's kind of our goal. That's what we'd like to see happen here. Throughout the rest of the evening, what we're going to do is have you have the opportunity to meet with our department heads. We're going to lead here, and we're going to go into 3 different breakout sessions. So they're going to be 15 minutes apiece. You can move throughout the building. You can see at the bottom of this front page here where we have the different departments, where they're going to be located throughout the next 45 minutes or so. We also have a map that's at the back of this packet, so you have an idea where you're going. We try to keep everybody within the first couple hallways, so you don't have to, you know, that's where a lot of people are. And then we have C200, which is, if you go upstairs, the big wide open rotunda area. There's 3 large rooms there. So we have social studies, where we have science and also mathematics up there as well. So as we go through to proceed, we'll run these 15-minute sessions. I'll make announcements over the PA system to move us from one place to another. But I really would like to thank you for coming out. It is very exciting to see all of you here tonight. And administrators will be available throughout the hallways. We'll also be available up here if anyone has some specific questions administratively we can answer. Thank you again for coming out. We hope you have a terrific evening, and we're going to go to session 1 at this time. Thank you.